Welcome to the complete story of Final Fantasy X, one of the most beloved entries in the Final Fantasy series. Back in 2001, Final Fantasy X was the first Final Fantasy game to feature fully voiced dialogue and a fully 3D world, showcasing the capabilities of the new PlayStation 2 hardware. However, just as the game was celebrated for being a technological milestone, both in terms of its in-game graphics and the quality of its pre-rendered cinematics, it is equally, if not more memorable, for its endearing cast of characters and fantastic story. I'm Pieter from Birds of Play, and in this video, I hope you join me as we revisit the complete story of Final Fantasy X from beginning to end. We have a long pilgrimage ahead of us, and I hope you'll be with us every step of the way. A group of travelers sit around a campfire in silence, until one of them, a young man of 17, breaks away from the group and climbs a nearby hill. What awaits him are the ruins of a city in the distance, teeming with disembodied spiritual energy. It is at this point that the young man begins to recount the story of how they reached this place, noting that this might be his last chance to tell it. The young man's story begins in the futuristic metropolis of Sanakant, where he is greeted by a group of admirers hoping to get his autograph. Not one to let his fans down, the young man writes his name, Titus, on a pair of studded balls, before saying goodbye to his fans and heading for the stadium where the Jack Memorial Cup is being held in honor of his late father, which Titus appears to have some mixed feelings about. Upon reaching the stadium, Titus once again has to make his way through the crowd that has gathered to watch the game. Inside, he takes a short rest in a shallow pool of water before going out into the playing field, which consists of two colossal rings circling a gigantic sphere of water, wherein two opposing teams are intended to battle it out by fighting over the dominion of a peculiar studded blue and white ball that they then use to score goals with. This is Blitzball, and Titus is the star player of the Sanakant Aves. But as the game seems to reach its peak, a gigantic wave approaches the city menacingly, threatening to destroy everything in its path. A mysterious figure clad in red robes greets the coming of the wave with a toast, before proceeding to casually stroll through a city that is gradually becoming aware of its impending doom. Eventually, the game is cut short by a barrage of projectiles emerging from the wave, destroying the stadium and forcing everyone present to run for their lives. Outside the Blitzball Stadium, Titus meets up with the mysterious man and identifies him as Auron. Still undisturbed by the situation, Auron tells Titus to follow him. While making their way through the city, time suddenly stops for everyone but Titus, as he is approached by a small boy in purple robes that tells him not to cry and that this is the beginning. The boy then vanishes, and Titus turns his attention back to Auron and the wave attacking the city. Auron reveals that the entity behind the attack is known as Sin, and gives Titus a longsword, telling him it's a gift from his father, Jekt. Instead of running away from Sin, however, Auron leads Titus towards the giant and allows the two of them to get sucked up into it. Titus loses consciousness and experiences a vision of his father. When Titus comes to again, he finds himself in the ruins of a dreary temple, where he manages to light a small fire to keep warm. Then suddenly a being that can only be described as a monster attacks him. As Titus does his best to fend off the creature, a third party of strangers blows through a nearby door, with one of them joining the fight against the monster. Once the monster has been quelled, Titus attempts to thank his rescuers, only to find out that they only speak a foreign language. Titus is captured and brought back to their ship, where the girl that helped him introduces herself as Riku, and tells him that they are Albed, a race of people who use forbidden machina technology, machina being this world's word for machine. In order to stay in their good graces, Peter's must accompany Riku on an underwater salvage operation, where they swim down into an ancient airship at the bottom of the ocean. Once their work is done, Tidus tells Riku about what happened to Sanakant. And for some reason, Riku seems reluctant to believe him. She tells him that Sanakant was destroyed 1,000 years ago, and that Sin's toxin has been known to affect people's memories. As Tidus and Riku continue to talk, the ship is attacked by Sin, and Tidus plummets into the ocean, losing consciousness once again. This time around, Tidus wakes up on a sunny beach, where he's greeted by a familiar sight. People playing blitzball. He kicks the ball over to them with an amazing display of skill, and they are instantly amazed by his moves. Upon making his way over, the leader of the group introduces himself as Walker, and tells Tidus that he is on Besaid Island. Like with Riku, Tidus tells Walker that he's actually from Sanakant, but Walker assures him that the city was destroyed 1,000 years ago by Sin, as a punishment for humans relying on the use of machina. Walker then leads Tidus back to the outskirts of Besaid village and asks him point blank if he would join the blitzball team, the Besaid Aurochs. The team has not won a game in the last 23 years, and Walker really wants to win next game since he's planning to retire from blitzball in order to become a full-time guardian. He also says that there's a good chance that someone might recognize Tidus at the tournament, since even though his memories might be compromised, there's no denying his skill as a blitzball player. Tidus agrees to Walker's proposal, and the two of them head into the village. At the entrance of the village, Walker pulls Tidus aside and teaches him the Yevon prayer, used to greet fellow Yevonites. Tidus is quick on the uptake, as he is already familiar with the gesture from his time in Sanakant, where the same movements symbolize the victory in blitzball. Later that day, Tidus follows Walker to the temple in Besaid. Being in the temple as an active place of worship, really driving the point home that he is in fact in a world different from his own. Inside the temple, Walker is worried that the apprentice summoner hasn't returned after undergoing the trials, but is forbidden from going to check whether everything is alright. When Tidus hears this, he disregards the priest's order and rushes into the trial to rescue the apprentice summoner. At the end of the trial, he encounters two guardians, the Ronso, Kimari, and Lulu, the Black Mage, making it just in time to see the apprentice summoner Yuna emerge from the Chamber of the Faith, the innermost sanctum of the temple, now a full-fledged summoner. Upon exiting the temple, Yuna performs her first summoning, calling forth the Aeon Valefor, which she received after praying to the faith in the temple. Later that night, the whole village celebrates Yuna's achievement, and Tidus is told to stay away from the summoner, since he had broken the rules of the temple. However, Yuna herself approaches Tidus, wishing to know more about him and Sanakant, but leaves the actual conversation for later. After the celebration, Tidus overhears Lulu scolding Walker for his interest in Tidus, telling him he only wants him around because he resembles his deceased brother Chapu. After eavesdropping, Tidus heads back to bed and rests for the journey ahead. The pilgrimage begins, and Yuna and her guardians, joined by Tidus, set out on the sacred journey across Bira to vanquish Sin. Walker suggests that someone might recognize Tidus at the blitzball tournament in Luka, but before arriving there, they must first make a stop in Kilika. The party sets out on the SS Leaky, and on the way across the sea, Tidus and Yuna get a chance to talk. Unlike the others, Yuna believes Tidus' story about Sanakant, because 10 years ago, a man named Jekt had worked as her father's guardian, Yuna being the daughter of High Summoner Braska, the last summoner to defeat Sin. On the voyage to Kilika, Tidus once again experiences an attack by Sin, this time fighting back, but to no avail. The encounter concludes with Sin wreaking havoc on Kilika, destroying much of the town and killing many of its inhabitants. Upon arriving in what remains of Kilika, Yuna performs ascending, intended to guide the souls of the dead to the far plane. In the world of Spira, the dead leave behind pyreflies, a form of spiritual energy, and unless a summoner performs ascending for them, they can turn into fiends. After getting some rest after a long day, the group heads to Kilika Temple, so that Yuna can enter the Chamber of the Faith and acquire her second Aeon. At the temple they meet the overly smug Luca Goers, another Blitzball team that had just finished praying at the temple for victory in the upcoming tournament. Since Titus isn't a guardian, he is not permitted to enter the Cloister of Trials. But once he is left to his lonesome, the summoner Donna and her guardian approach him and toss him into the trial anyway, due to her rivalry with Yuna for the title of High Summoner. Titus makes his way through the trial, and regardless of Donna's interference, Yuna obtains the Aeon Ifrit, making her visit to the Chamber of the Faith a success. The party continues its pilgrimage by heading to Luca, the second largest city in Spira, where Waka and Titus will take part in the Blitzball tournament. Titus confidently proclaims to the people present at the docks that the Perseid Orcs will break their losing streak and win the tournament, much to the amusement and bewilderment of those present. Moments later, Maester Seymour Guado and the Elder Grandmaester Yomika land at the dock, and Yuna and her party bear witness to their arrival, Seymour setting his eyes on Yuna in return. Once the tournament starts, Yuna hears a rumor that Orin, a legendary guardian to her father, has been spotted in Luca. She goes with Kimari and Titus to look for him. But while Kimari gets into a scuffle with fellow Ronso, Biren, and Yenke after they start harassing him at a local bar, Yuna gets kidnapped by the Albed. Titus joins Lulu and Kimari as they attempt to rescue Yuna, while Waka is in the middle of a match with the Albed Sykes. After rescuing Yuna, Titus learns that she is actually half Albed, a secret he must keep from Waka due to Waka's belief that the Albed are heretics. In the meantime, Waka and the Aurochs win the game, ending a 23-year-long losing streak without Titus's help. Titus nevertheless takes part in the finals against the reigning Spirian champions, the Luca Goers, leading the team while Waka recovers from having overexerted himself in the previous game. After the game, the stadium is attacked by fiends, and Titus and Waka join up with Auron to fend them off, before Maester Seymour Guado summons his Aeon Anima and makes short work of the intruders. When Titus and Auron are alone, Auron tells Titus about how he, Jecht, and Braska defeated Sin 10 years ago, just like Titus has already heard. But he adds that Sin is now Jecht, a claim that Titus refuses to believe. After their short reunion, Titus and Auron join up with the others, and Auron offers his service as a guardian to Yuna, which she happily accepts. Titus also becomes guardian. Then, before saying goodbye to Luca, Titus and Yuna share a heartfelt moment, forcibly laughing in the face of tragedy. The pilgrimage continues along the Mihan High Road, and after a long day of walking, the party decides to rest at Rin's travel agency, located around the halfway point of the high road. As the sun sets, Yuna explains the purpose of the pilgrimage to Titus and tells him about the final Aeon that is to be found in the ruins of Zanarkand, the final Aeon being the only thing powerful enough to defeat Sin. When they come to the end of the high road, the party is barred from going any further because of Operation Mihan. Just then, Maester Seymour arrives at the scene and tells the Crusaders standing watch to let them pass. What awaits them is the Mushroom Rock Road that is currently occupied by the Crusaders, as they have decided to cooperate with the Albed in a desperate attempt to defeat Sin using Forbidden Machina. Waka is furious over this plan since it goes against the teachings of Yevon, and is dumbfounded that the operation is sanctioned by a maestro of the Church of Yevon. Yuna and her party are invited to watch from a safe distance, but once the operation is underway, no place is safe, as the operation proves to be a disaster costing the lives of hundreds. In the aftermath of the battle, Yuna must once again perform ascending, and Orin explains to Tidus that the reason Sin showed up was that Jack wanted to see his son, and this time around, Tidus feels like he sensed him somewhere within Sin. Walking alongside the retreating crusaders, Yuna and her guardians make their way to Josei Temple, where they meet fellow summoner Isaru. He warns them that there have been rumors about summoners disappearing in the middle of their pilgrimages. After talking with Isaru, the party heads into the Cloister of Trials, and Yuna emerges once again from the Chamber of the Faith with a new Aeon, Ixion. As the pilgrimage continues, they make their way to the Moonflow. In order to get across, they must ride a strange creature known as the Shoopuff. As they ride the Shoopuff, Walker points out the ruins of a sunken city as an example of the hubris of those that used Machina in the past, but then they are attacked by a group of Albed that kidnapped Yuna once again, retreating into the water as quickly as they emerge from it. Tidus and Walker chase after them and end up retrieving Yuna and destroying the Machina that was used to hold her captive. On the other side of the river, Tidus is suddenly reunited with Riku as he finds her laying on the riverbank. Riku turns out to be the destroyed Machina's pilot, as well as Yuna's cousin, on her Albert side of the family. Riku joins the party as Yuna's guardian, and just like with Yuna's lineage, those in the know keep it a secret from Waka. Auron also gives his blessing, even though he is aware of Riku's race. Having reached the other side of the river, the group makes its way to Guado Salam, the home of the Guado. In Guado Salam, Seymour Guado invites Yuna and her guardians to his estate, and shows them a sphere recording of the Sanakund of old, still in its prime 1,000 years ago. Seymour shows them Lady Yuna Leska, the first summoner to ever defeat Sin, and her husband, Lord Seon. Seymour then proposes marriage to Yuna in the hope that the two of them might defeat Sin just like Lady Yuna Leska and Lord Seon had done 1,000 years in the past. Yuna doesn't give him an answer and instead decides to visit the Farplane for guidance, the Farplane being a place accessible from Guado Salam, wherein visitors can visit the dead. According to Riku, the images of lost loved ones viewable from the Farplane are nothing but an illusion and chooses not to enter. Auron similarly stays behind. Inside the Farplane, Tidus tries to conjure up an image of Jekt to no avail. This might be because Jekt is still alive as Sin, as it has been said that only the dead can appear in the Farplane. Instead of Jekt, Tidus accidentally summons forth an image of his mother, and Yuna explains that she must have accepted death, since she didn't need ascending to reach the Farplane. While inside the Farplane, Yuna summons her parents to help her make a decision about Seymour's proposal, and Walker is reunited with his brother Chapu. Upon leaving the Farplane, Jiskal Guado, Seymour's deceased father, forcibly exits the Farplane as an unsent, leading Yuna to perform ascending on him. Jiskal leaves behind a sphere, which Yuna promptly snatches up off the ground. After recovering from the incident, Yuna sets out to talk to Seymour, only to find that he has already left for Macalania, the next temple on the pilgrimage. Before arriving in Macalania, the party needs to cross the Thunder Plains, which takes a heavy toll on Riku, who is afraid of thunder. In order to get Riku to calm down, they stay at Wind's travel agency. As Tidus goes back to check on Yuna, he finds her privately viewing the sphere Jiskal had dropped back at the entrance of the Farplane. Before the party reaches the Macalania woods, Yuna announces that she is planning to accept Seymour's marriage proposal. While passing through the icy woods of Macalania, Auron drags the group along for a short detour to a pyrefly-infused pool of water. There they find a sphere left behind by Jekt for Tidus, containing an uncharacteristically sentimental message to his son. Auron tells Tidus that Jekt had accepted his fate to remain in Spira, and that he did in fact love him, something Tidus had had a hard time believing in the past. The party is once again ambushed by the Albed. this time with Riku's brother leading the charge. They defeat the Elbed and their machina, but as a result, Waka finds out about Riku's lineage and becomes enraged. While the other members of the group ride machina sleds to the temple, Waka makes his journey to Makalinia Temple on foot. At the temple, Yuna has already entered the Chamber of the Faith with Seymour standing watch outside, when Driscoll's sphere is discovered in Yuna's belongings. Chaos ensues, as it becomes apparent that the contents of the sphere detail how Seymour had murdered his father in order to become a maestro of Yevon and the leader of the Guado. Upon seeing this, the party enters the Cloister of Trials and confronts Seymour head-on. Yuna joins in the battle with her new Aeon Shiva, and together they are forced to kill him. The Guado then rush Seymour's lifeless body away and destroy Driscoll's sphere in order to hide any evidence of his wrongdoings. Yuna and her guardian is now being treated as traitors to the church, are forced to flee the temple with the Guado in pursuit. When they are almost home free, a fiend breaks through the frozen lake and sends them plummeting to the bottom of Lake Makalania. At the bottom of the lake, Yuna confesses that she was planning to marry Seymour in exchange for him turning himself in for his crimes. Suddenly the ground starts to shake, and the party realizes they have been standing atop Sin, made docile by the Hymn of the Faith emanating from the temple. A song that was also sung in Sanakant, and one that Jack was particularly fond of while still human. At that moment, Tidus truly understands that Sin is in fact Jacked. Once again getting swept away by the tides of fate, Tidus awakens on Bicanel Island, alone in an oasis. Wandering through the desert, he reunites with his fellow guardians one by one, but Yuna is nowhere to be seen. Thankfully, Riku knows where they are, and tells the rest of the party to follow her to the Elbed secret home, known simply as Home, but only if they promise to keep its whereabouts a secret. Upon reaching Home, Riku is shocked, as the base is under siege by Guado forces. Fighting their way through the invading army, the Guardians reach the Summoner's Sanctum. Tidus criticizes the Elbed for not trusting Guardians to protect the Summoners. Upon learning the truth behind the pilgrimage, however, Tidus breaks down emotionally. The truth being that summoning the final Aeon to defeat Sin will inevitably also kill the Summoner, meaning that Yuna will die if they manage to complete their journey. With the Elbed home being overrun, the Guardians board an Elbed airship, the Fahrenheit, the same ship Tidus had helped Riku salvage when they first met. The ship is captained by Riku's father and Yuna's uncle, Cid. And as the ship takes off with the remaining Elbed on board, Cid gives the order to blow up Home with the airship's missile system to get rid of the invading forces. Using the airship, the Guardians make their way to Bevel, the holy capital of Yevon, in order to rescue Yuna, which they hear is to be vet to the now unsent Seymour Guado, effectively making him a living dead. Tidus and the others crash the wedding, but end up being held at gunpoint, forced to watch Yuna go through with the ceremony. Afterwards, Yuna threatens to let herself fall off the tall tower if Seymour refuses to set her guardians free, ultimately making good on her word by diving off the edge. Before hitting the ground below, Yuna summons Valefor mid-air and heads to the Cloister of Trials. The Guardians break free and make haste after her. Along the way, they discover several machinas inside the temple, and Oren exclaims that this is the true face of Yevon, implying that the Church of Yevon are betraying their own teachings. Upon praying to the faith, Yuna is gifted with the Aeon Bahamut, but the group get arrested as they exit the Cloister of Trials. Yuna and her guardians are then swiftly put on trial for their crimes. Yuna makes the case that Seymour should be sent to the Far Plane, at which point Master Micah also reveals himself to be an unsent. These revelations trouble Kel Kuranso, but aside from the Ronso Meister, Yuna's demands fall on unsympathetic ears. While in captivity, Oren tells Tidus about the Spiral of Death that characterizes Spira, with the summoners sacrificing themselves to defeat Sin, only for Sin to be reborn once again. After having been found guilty at the sham trial, Yuna and her guardians are sentenced to the Via Purifico, a dungeon known for being inescapable. Yuna manages to reunite with Kimari, Lulu, and Oren, while Tidus, Waka, and Riku make a separate underwater escape. But at the end of Yuna's jailbreak, she is met by fellow summoner Isaru. Isaru, still faithful to the Church of Yevon, challenges Yuna to a battle of aeons, only to be defeated. The two groups meet up and make their way to the exit of Bevel, only to be intercepted by Seymour. Seymour tells them about his plan to save Spira from the cycle of endless death by ending all life. In order to accomplish this, he would become Yuna's final aeon, and upon defeating Sin, become Sin itself. Seymour transforms himself into an inhuman monstrosity and attacks the party, only to be defeated once again. Retreating back into the Macalania woods, Yuna breaks off from the rest of the party to be alone, her faith in Yevon understandably shaken. Tidus finds her out in the middle of a nearby spring. After having learned the truth of the final summoning, Tidus apologizes for talking about life after the defeat of Sin and tries to persuade Yuna to give up on her pilgrimage. Yuna entertains the thought for a moment with a smile on her face, before ultimately breaking down into tears. Tidus comforts her, and they share a kiss as a part of a tender moment under the light of a full moon. Afterwards, they return to the rest of the party and continue their journey to Sanakant, passing through the Calmlands and onward to Mount Gagaset, home of the Ronzo, and sacred land to Yevonites. At Mount Gagaset, Kelk and the Ronzo tribe give Yuna their blessing, even though she has been excommunicated by the Church of Yevon. Kimari also faces Biran and Yanke once more, finally proving his worth to his people. As they make their way over and across the mountain, Seymour attacks the Ronzo, leaving most of them for dead, including Kelk, Biran, and Yanke, that did their best to defend Yuna from this malicious meister. After having made short work of the Ronzo, Seymour lies in wait for the party as they bid farewell to the snowy slopes of the mountain. Seymour has grown more powerful since the last time the party faced him, but nevertheless, they manage to defeat him again. Once the battle is over, Yuna and the rest of the Guardians learn that Sin is in fact Tidus' father, Jekt. Having bested Seymour, the party pushes onward and comes across a large number of Faith lost in dreams. This encounter triggers something within Tidus and makes him experience a vision of his home in Sanakant. Once again, he is visited by the boy in the purple robes, who is actually the Faith of Bahamut, whose physical form is locked away within Bevel's Chamber of the Faith. The boy reveals to Tidus that Sin was created to protect Tidus' Sanakant and to ensure that no power would become strong enough to threaten its existence. He also tells Tidus that his Sanakant is actually just a dream maintained by the Faith, and that Tidus, Jekt, and everyone else from the city are in fact nothing but the dreams of the Faith, a dream that will come to an end if Sin is defeated once and for all. The boy nevertheless asks Tidus to defeat Sin so that the Faith may finally rest and be free of their endless state of dreaming. When Tidus awakens from his vision, he does not share what he has learned from Bahamut with the rest of the party. On the other side of Mount Gagaset, the party arrives at the ruins of the original Sanakant, the final destination of the pilgrimage. The group stops to rest, and this is where Tidus' retelling of what led them to this place and where our story began, ends. After resting up, the party makes its way to Sanakant Dome in order to meet Unaleska. The dome is teeming with pyreflies to such a degree that the visages of summoners past are present within the dome, their journey having been recorded. Inside the dome, Yuna and her guardians follow in the footsteps of Braska, Jekt, and a younger Oren until they finally reach the inner sanctum where Lady Unaleska awaits. Unaleska, now an unsent, tells them that in order to acquire the final Aeon, Yuna must first sacrifice one of her guardians in order to create it. As proof of this, they get a glimpse of the past, where Jekt volunteers to become Braska's final Aeon. Once the final Aeon defeats Sin, it is transformed into a new Sin, explaining why Jekt is now Sin and how the spiral of death, in Spira, continues to be perpetuated. Yuna refuses to further this tradition, for even though she might have been willing to sacrifice herself for the greater good, she is not willing to give up the lives of any of her guardians. Yuna Leska believes that without the final summoning, all efforts will fail, and attacks Yuna and her guardians to end their suffering and free them from despair. The group sees another vision of a young Auron, this time alone, since Braska and Jakt had already given their lives to defeat Sin. He attacks Yuna Leska, but is mortally wounded, meaning that he is currently an unsent. Auron, having made his way back to confront Yuna Leska all these years later, offers the party a choice to either die and be free of pain, or to live and fight their sorrow. They choose to fight back and end up defeating Yuna Leska, thereby ending the practice of the final summoning, the only known means of defeating Sin, dying along with Lady Yuna Leska. Refusing to give up, the party must find a new way to defeat Sin. With Sid's airship at their disposal, the team brainstorms some ideas and decides to pay Yo Maika a visit. When Maika learns they killed Yuna Leska and thereby the only means of defeating Sin, he willingly departs to the far plane, dissolving into pyreflies without the need for ascending. With Maika gone, the party needs to rely on its own knowledge about Sin to come up with a plan. Ultimately, remembering the way Sin was conned by the Hymn of the Faith due to Jack's love for the song, they spread the word and get everyone in Spira to sing the Hymn of the Faith. And while Sin is subdued, they begin their attack and manage to enter Sin's body. Inside Sin, the party once again encounters Seymour, this time in his most powerful form yet. Regardless of his latest upgrade, however, Seymour is defeated once more, but this time, Yuna manages to send him to the far plane. Much like Yuna Leska, Seymour believes that Spira's sorrow will continue. At Sin's core, Tidus is reunited with Jekt for a brief moment before he is completely taken over by Sin, turning into Braska's final Aeon. The party kills Jekt and saves him from being Sin, giving Tidus and Jekt one last moment together, where Jekt scolds his son affectionately for still being a crybaby. With Jekt gone, Yu Yevon, Lady Unaleska's father, and the ancient summoner that had originally summoned Sin in Sanikant 1,000 years ago, descends upon them. Formerly a great summoner, Yu Yevon is now a husk of his former self, mindlessly maintaining Sin's rampage. Looking for a new summon to replace Braska's final Aeon, Yu Yevon takes on Yuna's Aeon one by one, the party destroying each one as Yu Yevon possesses them. When Yu Yevon has nowhere left to hide, Yuna and her guardians destroy him, and thus destroy Sin. With Sin gone, Auron is content and requests that Yuna performs a sending for him. The faith that had been dreaming for 1,000 years also starts to disappear, along with Tidus. Yuna tries to stop Tidus from leaving, but unable to touch him, ends up falling through him. Tidus embraces her without actually being able to touch her, before jumping off the edge of the airship and falling through the clouds to be reunited with Auron and Jekt along with Yuna's father, Braska. Having become a high summoner like her father before her, Yuna delivers a speech at the Blitzball Stadium in Lucca, triumphantly proclaiming the death of Sin and that the eternal calm has now begun. She concludes by telling everyone present that the friends that have been lost along the way and the dreams that have faded should never be forgotten. In the depths of the ocean, Tidus wakes up and swims towards the surface, a smile on his face.
Hello everyone,
it's me, Nakwe, the other one.
Thanks for watching the complete story of Final Fantasy X, and what a story it was. If you liked the video, don't forget to pack that like button with your beak, and don't forget to subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. Also, how about leaving us a comment down below, telling us how you feel about Final Fantasy X's story, or how it has touched you. We'll be waiting, but for now, join us for some bird sounds.